Well, what time have we meeting? 12:30?
Yes.
Okay, so at 11:30 we have a board committee meeting.
So we have a full program today.
Yes.
Okay, we are live on YouTube.
I share the screen.
Hello, Pavel.
Good morning.
You're Marian.
Good morning, Marian. Nice to see you.
And William, hello.
Well, welcome, welcome. Thank you.
Okay, we can start the time.
Okay. So, welcome to everybody. We start with the session key five. My name is Marian Kaźmierkowski. I'm professor at the Electrical Faculty of the Warsaw University of Technology, and I will chair this session together with Professor William Fedak. The title of the presentation given by Professor Pavol Bauer is Power Flow and Protection in Low Voltage DC Systems. So, William, please introduce yourself and also the biography of the speaker.
Yes. Thank you, Marianne, and welcome all to the transmission. So let me briefly introduce myself. I am working at the Technical University of Košice at the Department of Electrical Engineering and Mechatronics. What concerns myself, I belong to the founding members of the PEMC Council together with Marianne. And I was general chairman of PEMC 2000 in Košice. Since the 90s, I am chairman also of the EDPE conference, Electrical Drives and Power Electronics. And you will have chance to see the details and announcement of the next EDP conference during the closing session. Professor Dai liked very much this conference, and he is considered that he was considered that the EDP is some kind of co-conference of the PEMC. So let's go now to the keynote speaker, Pavol Bauer. Pavol Bauer, he is currently a full professor at the Department of Sustainable Energy of the Delft University of Technology. And simultaneously is head of the DC Systems Energy Conversion and Storage Group. He was also appointed as professor by in Czech Republic and also in Timișoara in Romania. Since in years 2002 and 3, he was working partially in at KEMA. So yesterday we had chance during industry-oriented roundtable to hear this about this company. He was working on different projects related to power electronics applications and in power systems. He published a lot of papers. His publication field is rich, 100 journal papers, 120 journal papers, 500 conference papers, 8 books, and he holds 7 international patents and organizes as well several tutorials at the conferences. He was working in many fields in industry concerning wind and wave energy, power electronics applications for power systems, project for small cities as PV charging of electrical vehicles, PV and storage integration, contactless charging, and participates in many other projects. His main research is power electronics for charging of electrical vehicles and DC grids. Also, he is active in the fields of power in professional fields. He is senior member of IEEE, former chairman of Benelux IEEE Joint Industry Application Society, a power electronics and power engineering society chapter. And since 2016, he is chairman of Power Electronics and Motion Control Council, also member of Executive Council of European Power Electronics Associations, EPE, as well as member of many, many steering committees in international conferences. So now, Pavol, let's, after this short introduction, the floor is yours.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Let me thank you for this honor to present this keynote. I would like to first address the group name, DC Systems Energy Conversion and Storage. It shows what we are believing in and what is the development in the technology. Today I will talk about power flow and protection in low voltage DC systems. Often when you hear about DC systems, you hear about missing protection devices and circuit breakers because we are missing the zero crossing of the current. So let me first introduce my group. This is full scale of my group with 10 associate assistant professors and 8 technical staff. We have 26 PhD students, 7 upcoming, so we are hiring, especially European PhD students are welcome to apply. And I would like to you to remember the names of the assistant professors because you will hear from them. I'm very proud of this group and this team. Today we are burning fossil fuels and voltage and current is transported on the high level with the cables. We have transformers which are creating the backbone of our system. And this is situation of today which is not sustainable. In the future, we will see wind energy offshore, solar energy in the south, for example, and a lot of DC current on a very high voltage. It's already a reality, and also on the low voltage DC current. So what will happen is also local generation and local consumption will grow. And I will address this part with the DC microgrids story. What we see also is the increased role of power electronics in the grids and digitalization. There are some disruptive technologies, except this digitalization, it's also storage, which will completely change our views on the grid and on the energy supply. And the direct current is a potential technology also making a big change and a big impact. So what we see is the following. At this moment, we have AC grid with the control and stability, where the production follows demand. And we want to go to sustainable, reliable, high efficient, low cost distribution grid, but with the energies from the sources like solar and wind, and a lot of electrical vehicles, which could be partially DC, where the demand follows production. So not the production follows demand, but demands follow production more closely. Flexible and modular grid with decentralized control, a new cost and market structure and system integration with the other carriers like gas and electricity integration. Why we are doing that? Well, because we want to go to CO2 reduction and the energy from the renewable energies and electric vehicles, and also partially the infrastructure is aging. Most of the grids designed in Europe are 50, even 70 years old. There is some uncertainties, I will not address them, and there is also how. And how is to redesign the system for partially DC, integrate the storage, and more system of system approach. So I will talk about redesign the system of the partially DC. In this case, if I draw the system on DC, then we will see the new component, which is the power electronic converter. In the previous keynote speakers, Mariusz Malinowski, but also Johan Kolar, mentioned the solid state transformer, which will replace the classical transformer of 50 Hertz. And this component will allow tighter power flow of from the high voltage to the medium voltage and low voltage. So we envision the growth of the DC grids from the maybe lower level. You can see here a DC house and interconnecting different connections with the DC. You can see that this growth will be organic. Yeah. Of course, you can have DC grids organized a different way. For example, here you see bipolar single bus, bipolar with the plus minus, some countries believe in plus minus 90 volt. We are believing in plus minus 350 volt. What you see is the connection of the photovoltaics via DC converter to this grid. You see the different loads, you see the different battery bank, it may be a backup diesel generator. If I translate it to the power electronics, then you can see the detailed layout of the power electronic converter and translated the controls. We have a grid forming elements and grid feeding elements. All this you can learn from the course we are delivering at the Delft University of Technology, DC and AC microgrids course. Possibly is also hybrid grid, again, with number of converters connecting different sources and loads, and translated to the detailed layout is this translation, and again, control scheme from the grid forming infinity elements is shown on the figure. But now today I want to talk about DC distribution and DC grids. Of course, there are many arguments why, and I will not repeat them. This is very clear, I think, already. Even some of them are controversial, like higher system efficiency or lower overall investment cost. But I would like to maybe talk about the expectations from the, and where we are now in the acceptability curve. And if you look at this curve here in the right below, then you see the peak of inflated expectations. We were, I think, over this peak already. Now we are somewhere in the valley of the disillusionments and we are climbing up. So the DC grids are slowly and without any big visibility, getting ground on the application field and everyday life. So the transformer is the missing element. And I will not address transformer, I will just present the roadmap for DC systems, which we build up from DC nanogrids version 2.0, microgrids, least link, radial grids, and mesh distribution grids. You can see many points on this chart, and I will very briefly address some of them, very briefly address some projects and some PhD topics, and I will focus on the protection and power flow control. So the first one is bidirectional power flow. The example of this kind of topic is, for example, trolley bus charging, the PhD of Ibrahim Diab, where we are looking at the trolley bus network in the city of Arnhem. There is a European project with more cities connected, also from Hungary and Poland, by the way. And the cities are having a trolley bus network, which is passive network, supplied by 12 pounds rectifier. If you make it active network, adding PV arrays, adding storage, adding the charging of the buses of the electrical vehicles, we can make it active network with bidirectional power flow. A lot of converters are needed for that, but also protection devices and circuit breakers. PV and storage is a winning configuration. You can start it to do it on the low module level, connecting the PV and storage with the power electronic converters, creating some kind of DC, small DC system, or you can do it on a distribution level. Today we had a presentation from Marco Steca. His PhD topic is design of energy storage power electronic converter, and looking at the optimal placement of each, not only DC, but also AC grids, looking at the placement, looking at the sizing and control of such a storage. And we built a hardware loop simulation in the laboratory of the Delft University of Technology. Second topic connected is the DC house nanogrid. Here I will spend a little bit more time on this topic. We envision some kind of DC house with a lot of technologies connected, with a lot of PV, lots of storage, DC, electrolytes connected. And if you realize such a house, you can find a lot of references on these realizations. You can see it done from the discrete components like PV panels connected via DC-DC converter to the backbone of the 350 volt. Then you have a converter for storage, converter for lighting system, which is usually on the lower voltage, 48 or 60 volt. So realized by discrete components. The challenging by these discrete components is the communication need, and centralized control is difficult. Stability issues, many components interacting. So it has some drawbacks. But still, what we did, we realized this concept in the one of the buildings of the TU Delft. The building is shown on the right, top corner. It's so-called pulse building. And this building is realized on the DC technology. So we see, I try to get my pen first that I can show it. Or highlighter, maybe laser pointer is better. Yes. So it's 350 volt converters for the DC-DC for solar energy. Then we have a backbone of 350 volt, make connection to the grid, 150 kilowatt. And then we have a 60 volt DC system for USB-C ports and also for USB classical, some lighting system and battery system. So this building is opened 2 years ago, and now we have first experience from a typical TC building from the TU Delft campus. The currently used houses, the AC houses with fuses and radial layout is shown on this picture. What we see is that every group of the appliances has its fuses for 16 or 32 amperes. And if you look at the different features, you can see that there are some drawbacks on this. And for example, energy efficiency, availability, reliability, control, and scalability. I will not address them all, but this kind of system is vulnerable to grid outages and faults. And if there is a grid outage or fault, the whole house is also suffering on that. Our solution, which we propose, and this is a solution we are working on it on already for 5 years, is so-called smart power router. And the smart power router is a concept which is capable of manipulating power flows in all directions. So you can manipulate power flow from photovoltaics directly to the car without the grid. You can go to the photovoltaics to the appliances or to the battery, and you can become more independent. And connection, main connection to the grid can become smaller and less dependent. So the solution has also control layers here shown in the picture. And let's see now this solution in the practice. So the solution is based on the multi-active bridge converter controlled by the phase shift. You see the basic control principle. Every input voltage is controlled by the phase shift. And this way we can control the power flow. The problem is that the power flow is not decoupled. So what we have here is equivalent circuit of this transformer. And what you see is that the disadvantage is that power flows are coupled, as it can be seen by the power flow equation. The power flow between any two ports is dependent on the phase shift between the two ports. So if I change the power flow from the two ports, then all the power flows are also dragged within together. So this is really the advantage of this classical approach. If I look at it critically, then complexity is increasing the number of ports. And if I have a number of ports, only four, then I have 26 power flows. So it's actually, transformer design is very challenging, but it's also a control nightmare. It's a control nightmare because the non-diagonal elements in a matrix are always non-zero. For example, this is the non-diagonal elements. And you can see that they depend on the leakage inductances. Coupling depends on the individual leakage inductances which are present. So in the solution we proposed, we are decoupling power flow by applying asymmetric distribution of the leakage inductance in the ports. The master port, this is the leakage inductance in the matrix, the master port acts as a voltage source converter, controlling the AC voltage across the transformer magnetizing inductance. And then we have a slave ports, which are decoupled from the master port, and they're decoupling the slave to slave interaction. Of course, the advantage is the master port has to absorb the full energy. The leakage inductances in this case for master port and for slave port are decoupled. And you can see that the matrix will change to diagonal matrix. Experimental prototype was built and the transformer designed. The PhD defense of this work is on schedule on 2nd of June, and it will be also broadcasted on the Zoom. This is the experimental prototype. Conventional multi-active bridge converter dynamics and proposed dynamics shows that we are able to decouple power flow and control independently on the. There are some patents pending on this design, and we are continuing the story of research. Then PV charging system of electric vehicle. We designed also electrical bike and scooter charging station with 48 volt DC with a charge controller, and one of the bikes is also controlled with wireless charging. We have a startup company called Tyler. If you type Tyler in the Google, you'll find it. And it's going to be a product which is put on the market right now. So electric vehicles are really the enabling technology for future DC grids, because they are very batteries on the wheels. And what we designed is, between others, charging station, where normally the charging happens that photovoltaics is put energy to the grid. And again, the DC charging is realized by a separate charging converter. In our design, this DC charging is realized by one converter, where we are merging together the PV converter with the charging converter and inverter. This way, we allow charging directly from photovoltaics in the building on the house. This concept is going to be expanded also for buildings and for the parking garages. You can imagine a lot of photovoltaics on the roof of the, for example, office buildings, and without the grid in between, we can charge directly the car. Of course, we can also add storage to that. This converter was designed. This is the layout of the converter with interleaved boost converter for photovoltaics, with the interleaved flyback stages for the charging, and with inverter to the main grid. We obtained some prices for that, for example, the best innovation of the electric vehicles price in Berlin. This is just a glimpse of DC system we are now or developing now for DC charging, with the multiplexing, where a lot of photovoltaics will be placed on the parking garages, and where the cars will be connected to the ultra fast charging stations, and the multiplexing relies on different level. This is the simplest level with these connectors. Will be more cars charged simultaneously at the same time. Adding storage to that, again, William Vermeer had today paper about the AC charging, adding storage to the typical charging system, and adding some kind of also loads like a heat pump, is expanding this concept for larger buildings. We are going to we are developing energy management algorithms, and add battery charger, add battery port, which makes the buildings again more independent. I'd like to also briefly mention that DC is technology which is existing, but there is no DC devices. So often the consumers are asking us, can we connect the washing machine, or can we connect any device to the DC? Well, most of the devices are of the DC nature. So 90% of devices work fine with the DC. What we made in this paper is study and comparison. What does it mean, put the devices in DC? So for example, here is a rectification and boost converter with power factor correction. And it shows that if the voltage is large enough, then efficiency of the DC system is good enough. What I am, my plea is to introduce so-called DC ready. Maybe you remember the nightmare from the 90s when we had devices bought in America where only were working for 120 volt and 60 hertz or 50 hertz, 60 hertz. Not. Now we have devices, all the power chargers are working for all the voltage levels and all the frequencies. Something like that has to be introduced also for DC ready devices, where the consumer will see that the device is also working for DC. Next in the topic would be a cellular concept. We foresee the growth of the DC as a cells independently organized and connected via medium voltage DC. So you can see selection of the voltage levels from plus minus 350 to 700 plus minus, which is still below the low voltage DC level of 1500 volt. Protection and grounding. This is the main topic of my speech today. So the system should be protected, and it should be safe, sensitive, secure, selective, fast, and cost effective. I will talk about protection, which is sensitive, and most importantly, also selective, and of course, fast. So the biggest challenge on the low voltage DC system protection is that we have a lack of zero crossing. Fast interaction is required because the prolonged fault currents can cause a blackout and require power electronic components to be designed for longer and higher fault currents, which means that if you don't have a fast protection, we have to oversize converters on the system, also on the chargers. So we don't want to oversize the converters. We need to really have a fast interruption. There is a low inertia in the network, and we need to design protection on the very fast level. The fault, if the fault is interrupted fast, it's more difficult and to measure and to locate and ensure selectivity. I will show it in the example. To locate and ensure selectivity is a challenging task, especially in the mesh system where the selectivity is more challenging. The direction of the current cannot be used as additional information. In the radial system, it can be used, but in the mesh system, it's difficult to use it as an information direction. So what we came up is the different protection zones. It's crucial to know the dangers and requirements for interacting with different parts of the grid. Therefore, the grid is partitioned in the different protection zones where the protection is able to galvanically isolate the zones from each other. So we suggested a couple of zones. The zones are designed on the short circuit potential. Here is an example. Zone zero occurs at the interface of the low voltage grids and the macro grid, or other medium high voltage application, for example, a wind turbine. The zone one is the medium and high voltage, about 59 volt. It has a potential for highest short circuit. We can go on until zone three, which is the zone of the device level, 42 volts, safe to touch. USB-C, for example, is a typical example of zone three. If you want to know more, you can find the paper in the references. In these zones, which we previously divided, we have also several so-called tiers. The different tiers within one zone could have a no guaranteed protection or device protection with internal protection or overcurrent protection, interrupted by specific current is happening, and the current prevention protection. So the different tiers are the parts of the zone that do not provide any protection for faults and a short circuit fall under a tier A, for example. This tier occurs, for example, at the terminals of source and storage devices. Since this tier does not provide any guarantee on the safety or survivability of entities and devices interacting with the tier, the probability of serious injury or damages can be high. Therefore, any possibility for interaction with this tier should be minimized. So if there is no guaranteed protection, this zone cannot be touched. The tier B, for example, there is no autonomous protection devices are present. It's internal protection and so on, and we can go on with the other tiers. So low voltage DC faults in this figure, you can see a simplified equivalent circuit of a short circuit fault in a monopolar DC grid. You see the line, inductance, capacitances, the typical pi model of the line with resistances, short circuit, and a circuit breaker with internal resistances and inductances. Right after the fault occurs, assuming that the capacitance of the line is negligible, the fault current is given by the equation, which we see on the screen. And what we need is the current limiting inductances and fast fault interruption to prevent the system from reaching its large steady state currents. If you want to get an impression how these currents propagate, how they fast propagate, this is the graph showing the dependence on the limiting inductance. You can see that the division is 5 microseconds, and the DC currents are growing fast depending on the limiting inductance. Within a couple of microseconds are growing into the several hundreds of amperes. I don't see the scale. The scale is 200 amperes per division. So within a few microseconds, the currents grow very fast. So we need additional inductance in the circuit breaker to limit the current rise. So in the slide which we just previously had, I explained the dynamics of the fault in the system, and the capacitor discharge and the inductances are very small. So here we have three different types of the protection devices. The first type is the hybrid circuit breaker, which is very slow. Reaction time is an order of 10 milliseconds. Then we have a hybrid circuit breaker, and then we have a solid state circuit breaker. And we see that from the point point of view of the current rising, only the solid-state circuit breaker on the low voltage DC grids is really fast enough to react on the good level. In the table is shown the speed, reliability, and the solid-state circuit breaker is reacting the fastest and also has a lifetime of requested lifetime. So this is an example of such a solid-state circuit breaker, and it's showing operation during the fault clearing. This is the fault clearing of a solid-state circuit breaker. The stage one starts after the fault occurs, and the circuit is dominated by the inductance. So we can see that the sharp rise of the current here through the switch and the inductor current. Then in the stage two starts after the solid state circuit breaker MOSFETs are opened. So the MOSFETs are here opened. And the consumer capacitor is charged. And here we can see the current reaction. And the last stage is the discharge of the summer capacitor. Now, I already mentioned how important it is to detect the solid state circuit breaker short circuit current. So we need to have a system which reacts fast on the short circuits. It can be done by different detection methods. In this figure, we can see two detection methods. The first one is the just overcurrent detection. You see here the current rising and detection of the overcurrent is on the cross point on the set point of this current, which is meant to be short circuit current. Usually it's a double of the nominal current, but it still means that the whole system has to be designed for this double current. The other one is the DIDT detection, rate of change of current detection. So the DIDT looks like more healthy and much faster. The difference between these two is of course quite clear. The DIDT can trip almost immediately and the overcurrent detection has to wait until the current comes to the predefined value. So again, it seems that there is a room to make the detection process faster if DIDT is used. The question is how much influence implementing of this DIDT has on the overall size and current voltage stress on the circuit breaker. So let's have a look at this. Left is the overcurrent detection and right is the rate of the current of the change current rate of change of the current detection. The message here is that the influence of the DIDT detection on the peak current, this is the peak current, on the different delay times, on the different delay times for both detections. So the influence of the DIDT detection on the peak current is not that large, as the overcurrent protection thresholds are not super high for a circuit breaker, often only double of the nominal current, and the current rises very fast. Moreover, the delay computing time is very short, so the influence of the DIDT is not necessarily so huge. Also, the figure shows quite clearly that if the size of the summer capacitor, this is the size of the summer capacitor, that will be decisive for the peak current. You can see that for the peak current is rising with the summer capacitor value. It is critical with regards to the absorbed energy when the inductance is very small, as the overvoltages can be smaller than by overcurrent only is used. The energy in the fault is also important for the choice of the metal oxide varistors. I will show you in the next design. But let's first look at the overvoltage comparison. It can be seen that we had an assumption that if you can keep it under 900 volt, then superjunction silicon switches can be used, which could make the overall design cheaper. That is partially, we are looking into the influence of different detection methods from the designer perspective. So we have a trade-off. What can we gain as a designer if the solid state circuit breaker, when we invest more in the detection method, because obviously this detection method of the rate of change of the current detection is much more complicated than overcurrent detection. or could we potentially use silicon switches? So there's a trade-off. Either you invest more in the switches or you invest more in the rate of the change of the current detection. These are two designs. One of them is from silicon MOSFETs and one of them is from silicon carbide MOSFETs. And we compare the performance of these two designs. Here is the test of the overcurrent protection. On the left graph is the overcurrent detection. The time scale is, if I'm correct, then I don't see it now. I thought it's 5 microseconds. But the time scale on the DIDT detection is much shorter. Oh yeah, the 5 microseconds per division, and here is the time scale of 2 microseconds per division. You can see that the peak current is approximately the same. The current is the same, and the overvoltage also comparable. The prototype number 3, with use of the metal oxide varistors in service numbers, was also tested, and compared with the other two designs. So basically we have design of the solid state circuit breaker and now the selectivity. So selectivity has to assure fast fault interruption also in the mesh structures, and changing grid topologies make it difficult to selectivity. I will address this fast fault propagation and commutation of inductive currents. So first, the low impedance, low inductance microgrid. On the picture, you see a typical example of the microgrid with the current loads, PEMC is a current source and one voltage control device. And what happens is that in the low inductive system, the DIDT or current can exceed the threshold at multiple locations. So you see here a short circuit happening in the circuit breaker 3. This is the orange line. The current is growing rapidly to negative values. At the same time, the current is drawn also from the circuit breaker 2, red one, and circuit breaker 1, which is also exceeding the threshold. The DIDT detection on the right figure is showing circuit breaker 2. So in such a system, the fault propagates quickly, and we wanted to isolate fault in the circuit breaker 3, but actually all other two circuit breakers also tripped, which is not what we want. So to ensure that this doesn't happen, the propagation of the faults should be prevented. But the question is how? The second example is the system where inductances are present, and another issue can occur. In this situation, for example, in the connected household nanogrid, in such a system, the inductive pre-fault current in the line is 10 amperes, so 10 amperes for both loads. And what happens is if I get a short circuit, for example, here in the short circuit is shown in the red light, that is CB2, the orange one, then it's tripping. The full inductance current, which was previously going to the circuit breaker 2, when it's tripping, then it's going to be pushed to the circuit breaker 1, which is also on the right figure showing exceeding the threshold value of, for example, here 21 amperes shown in the figure. So in this case, both circuit breakers carry a non-faulted steady state current of 10 amperes. And therefore there is a 20 ampere in the inductive line. And when a short circuit occurs, the current in circuit breaker 2 rises quickly to its threshold value and detection is tripped. So this is a similar problem to the previous one, now with inductive lines. Now, how to prevent those problems is that we have to add some small filters for fast fault propagation by modifying the topology of the circuit breaker, such as that LCR filters are delaying the propagation. The characteristic of the filters, currently multiple nominal currents, is shown here. And adding these filters in the circuit breaker creates a impedance path. So it's not only capacitance, but also high frequency oscillation with low damping could occur, between the damper capacitor through the current limiting inductance. So the resistances are added to the dampers in order to attenuate these oscillations. So we added also resistances to these dampers. And in the proposed topology, the RC dampers together with the current limiting inductance form a low pass RCR filter. And this low pass RCR filter, additional benefit of this damper capacitance is that it delays and smooths the commutation of an inductive current. The detailed design of this LCR filter is described also in the paper in the reference. Now, we tested this so-called plug and play system, and we tested it in the meshed grid, and it shows that the decentralized plug and play protection scheme also works for the mesh system. The experiment is shown on the right of this figure. The setup consists of a constant voltage source of 350 volt connected to the two 5 ampere constant current loads in ring configuration. The lines in the systems are emulated by equivalent circuits with an inductance and resistance of different values, 32 microhenry and 120 milliohm respectively. And the experimental results are for the currents inside the circuit breaker when a short circuit with a fault resistance of 2.5 ohm is induced on the load side terminal of circuit breaker 3 here are given in the figure on the right. So it shows that this circuit breaker doesn't react neither on the inductance nor on the other situation. Stability of DC grids is something which is addressed in the PhD of the Niels van der Bly.
3 minutes.
What?
3 minutes up to end.
I got 45 minutes.
Sorry. Yeah.
Sorry for, I asked for at the beginning of presentation, I thought it's 45 minutes.
That's what I okay, got. Let's go.
Okay. Okay, I will skip this stability issue and go to the optimal power flow and the power flow controller. So this power flow controller shows that typical example of the meshed line, when the line current is given by the difference of the voltages and line resistance, but when one of the nodes is connected, then of course the line two current draws some current and the line one can be overloaded. So our proposed solution is to introduce some kind of voltage control device, which can be either passive resistance, full converter, or voltage in series. And voltage in series can be injected by the converter, which is injecting the voltage in series with the line. Now, this is the power flow controller. It shows, the simulation shows that it works, that if I have the two lines and in parallel lines, and I want to influence the line current in one line, that the series voltage is influencing the current, then we design such a component. It looks like unified power flow controller on the AC circuit. What is here shown is the dual active bridge with the rated voltage on the full voltage side and rated, partially rated power flow controller, partially voltage and rated current on the DC side. And we can inject the current in the voltage in the different direction and this way influence the power flow. Advantage of this equipment is that we can also integrate the the solid state circuit breaker in this whole concept. This is the design of this component, and the testing shows that we can really influence the power flow and inject the voltage and requested value. Also testing with the short circuits on the both sides, on the left side and right side was provided, and the testing shows that integrated rated voltage integrated solid-state circuit breaker is also operating fine. Okay, so if I have to finish it, then I will close it here. Just last remarks. The things I wanted to address is the refurbishing the system for partially DC, and the refurbishing the system would be meaning that we are using the same cable, just refurbishing it, adding converters on both sides and using the DC. We would have possibilities to do it in parallel with one of the three cables, for example, or just interconnect the two faces and balance it. The refurbishing of the cable on the medium voltage is meaning for 10 kilometer cable, for 10 kilovolt cable, something like 60% enhancement of the power, so we can get 60% more power. This is important for the centrum of the cities like Amsterdam, where digging a new cables or laying new cables will be very difficult and very expensive. So adding the converters on the both sides creates a capacity enhancement. And this is showing the classical three cable, three-phase system. And then if I refurbish it, this classical system is N minus one contingent. So both cable failure or transformer value gives me still 20 megavolt ampere capacity. If I refurbish it and add converters on the medium voltage and we design this converter on MMC based technology, you can increase the capacity at the same time still maintain N minus one contingency. Okay, this is all what I want to say today, and thank you for your attention. I'm open for questions.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for to keeping the time schedule. And now I open the discussion. So we are waiting for the question from audience. I don't see, maybe I will start the discussion. You presented so many really difficult problems related to DC systems. But I wanted to ask you, the reliability, of course, is the one of the important points. And there are developed some methods of reliability-based design. This is one point. And the second point is, I think that to keep high reliability and develop these systems, we need to work and develop also the power electronics building blocks with high reliability. And this, from our point of view, required the very strong cooperation with companies. How you see this point? Reliability and development of buildings blocks.
So I would like to address the first question. The reliability is very important issue. And this is the question I always get from especially people from the utilities who are concerned about the reliability of power electronic converters. So the answer is that design of the converters should be made on the modular level. With modularity, we can build in redundancy. This is one way of looking at the reliability, which is meaning that I have more modules connected in parallel or series depending on the configuration and needed solution. And this way I can build in redundancy and replace also modules which are maybe less reliable or aging or having some problems. So this is the first question. Of course, reliability is very important topic. Fred Bliaberg is doing a very good work in research on reliability. And from May 1st, I'm having a starting tenure track candidate, Aditya Shekhar, who is going to focus especially on the reliability of power electronics in the grids. So we are also building up this topic. The second question was related to, what was the second question, please, can you repeat it?
Power electronics building blocks.
Oh, power electronics building blocks.
Cooperation with companies.
Yes, I think it's going to be with the building blocks complex situation. We can use them for sure as a building blocks for modularity. At the same time, the solution for every voltage level, for every different solution needs a different approach and different solution. So we need a number of power electronic building blocks in order to satisfy all the needs. And so far, my experience is that we need to have a tailor-made solutions for situations which are for different solutions for different problems. So power electronic building blocks is for sure the future. in the keynote of Johan Kolar on Monday, we saw the 3D integration also as a trend, which is a great trend. On one side, it can be a basic building block for many solutions. At the same time, I still think that we need to have tailor-made solutions for every problem and for every situation.
Yes, but you are working in a very practical direction, and I hope you have also cooperation with producers. Yes,
we have a cooperation with producers, with the companies. All the project which you saw, there are companies involved in this projects. We are having close cooperation with Infineon, with companies in Netherlands like Alphen or DNVGL or Kema, as well as Shell and many other companies involved in the wind energy and solar energy applications. And our topics are related to the DC grids and the charging of electric vehicles. Especially the charging topic is really expanding very fast, and contactless charging is one of the issues. But we have about 10 students of the charging, 10 PhD students for charging technology only, which shows that the need for the tailor-made solutions for 50 kilowatt chargers, for 350 kilowatt chargers, for contactless chargers, these solutions are all of them different, and different semiconductors are used, different application fields, different consumers, different requirements, showing that the solution is always made on tailor-made solution.
I see. By the way, how big is how large is the power you achieve with inductive power transfer?
We have now a 50 kilowatt charger for inductive power transfer, and we have to deliver within European or its national project 200 kilowatt charging system for electrical buses. And okay, we have to have it within 2 years, but we build it from 50 kilowatt on the modular system, again, modularity. So we built four modules of 50 kilowatt to create the 200 kilowatt charging system.
This
company is called Heliox in Eindhoven, and they are building a kind of charger for the buses, and we are delivering the charging system for wireless charging of electrical buses.
Okay, thank you from my side.
Okay.
More questions?
I would like no question. We have no.
Okay, so let us finish.
Yes. I would like to announce the next program, because the next session starts in this.
If I may.
But for effort committee. Yeah. Yes. Announcement for the board committee. We meet in lobby. Lobby you will find on a green field in the program on the website. Yes. Contact the lobby and we go there. And at 12:30 we have a PEMC Council meeting.
Could you repeat, William? Because it was some break.
Yes. Also, I lost the connection during the presentation. But meeting award committee is at immediately now in lobby meeting of your committee and the PMC Council at 12:30.
Okay.
Yes, from Council, I sent a separate invitation.
And also, I see that Professor Marek Kaczynski would like to ask something.
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I think I had some problem with the connection. Thank you very much, Professor Bauer, for a very interesting and very nice presentation. I was impressed. I wonder if you have any estimation what is the cost of the energy transition, because this is like it would be like a revolution in an energy system. Is there any, let's say, analysis how to introduce this into the market, those solutions?
There are several answers. The first answer is, what is the cost of not doing energy transition on the planet? This is also something to take into consideration. But the costs are very simply, we are working on the comparison, and I think that one of my PhD students is at this moment, William Vermeer, who is working also on the comparison, adding storage and adding storage the grid instead of the making grid more heavy. So if you really want to have a solar energy widely spread on the roofs of the houses, if you want to have electrical vehicles, if you want to have also heating without gas with the heat pumps, some predictions are really showing that the grid should be make heavier 3 to 5 times, which is impossible cost. We don't even have enough copper in the world to make this happen. And as well, the costs are in the billions. I'm not sure if this data is public, and I will try to refer on that in next opportunity. What we are comparing now, for example, is a simple distribution grid example where charging is happening, where photovoltaics are happening, and we are trying to compare the grid improvement or grid make it heavier with comparison to adding additional storage. And the grid data is based on the data which we got from the company called Stedin, which is a DSO. I remember it's about 100 euro per meter of the cable lying. You can add all this cost together, and you will come up with a huge amount of money for making it happen for energy transition. Mm-hmm. At the same time, we are using just last sentence to add to that. So I cannot quantify the cost for the whole country, for the whole Europe. I think nobody can at this moment, but for sure the local energy production, local energy consumption, like photovoltaics on your roof and charging directly your car, are typical solutions which are helping to decrease the load on the grids. At the same time, also photovoltaics on the roof and having the battery or fuel pump or heat pump would create a local energy consumption, local energy production. So these are the small steps in a big topic of energy transition.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for this answer. Yeah. And I have an impression personally that all of us are before the revolution, because everyone now has a personal computers. Nobody, I wonder what for our personal computers are. But now this is just my impression, and based on your presentation, I found that probably this is the right choice to go into nano power, to go into nano DC grids, and to go into let's say nano power electronics, personal converters that we can program quite easily, and we can process the energy from DC to AC and opposite.
Can I add to that? I have on my house, I have a solar cells on the roof, nine panels with 2.3 kilowatt peak power. And I have micro converters. And I have a DC grid, 350 volt, and then an inverter going to the main grid. I can add storage there, which is making a DC grid. I can connect my washing machine, and I'm planning to connect also my dryer to this DC grid, which would decrease my consumption from the main grid. If I produce the energy myself, it will be cheapest for everybody, not only for me, but also for the grid, because the grid is not loaded, super loaded. So these kind of solutions are already existing, and not many people realizing it, that this is already happening. Similar thing is about the kitchen. You have appliances in the kitchen, like dishwasher, like the oven, like electric system for your cooking, and microwave, etc. If you connect it on the DC on the back, and you save all the power supplies from AC to DC, because they're all DC. If you save that and you connect it to the PV, you can create a small solution. So these are small steps where the consumer will not see it at all. He will not see any difference, but these are small steps to the DC systems. And if you have more houses connected like that, interconnection is obviously the next step. So it will grow organically, and I believe it will grow without really making it, without ordering it, without even noticing it. So this is my
last point. May I interrupt you, because you have a topic for another keynote lecture at next PMC. So we have to really finish, if you allow.
Thank you very much.
Yes? Thank you.
Okay, so thank you all for coming here, and probably we shall continue according to the time schedule.
Thank you very much.
Goodbye.
Thank you.
Goodbye.
Will somebody send a link for the PEMC Council meeting now or not?
It was sent already to you. I will send it again.
Okay, please.
Same as the usual. Pavol.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
No, I sent already the link, so I can repeat sending the link, but I'm sure I send it.
Yeah.
It's a Zoom link.
Paul, excellent presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marek.
Do you have 3 minutes? One
yes,
question.
I have, yes. I have 3 minutes,
what was the cost of the investment in your house for the DC microgrid? This is the
four
way
and
of estimation.
€4,500.
Oh, and this is the way of estimation of real cost for our. Let's say.
Yeah, but I am getting it back because I am, to be honest, I don't pay any electricity bill for last 4 years. Mm-hmm. So usually I calculated that my payback time will be 7 years.
Okay, good, excellent.
So this system will be live hopefully for 15 or 20 years. So I paid back. So I see it as a good investment. Of course, nobody wants to lose money. But if I am making good investment at the same time contributing to the energy transition and CO2 reduction, what is better than that?
Yes, nobody knows, but definitely investment into the future to energy saving. And of course, I think the better investment is investing in our students and young professionals.
Because
I see the time is approaching. We already after the time. So let me start the next session, Professor Bauer.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much for very interesting presentation again and excellent discussion. So I would like to welcome all of you for the student and young professional keynote and competition final. This is my highest honor to be virtually in Gliwice now in Poland. I also would like to welcome Vice President for membership of Industrial Electronics Society. Thanks to his activity, I see Josef has a nice background. Awesome. I would like to invite him to give a short message to students and young professional, but not only for student and young professional, for all of the researchers, because Industrial Electronics Society is a special place, isn't it, Josef?
Yes. Thank you very much, Marek. All right. Good morning, I think now. Good morning at your end. It is it's nearly 10 to 8 p.m. here. It is wonderful to be with you guys in Poland. And I had a big affinity with Poland and Polish people and all the members of PEMC that we've been working together, as you know, for nearly 2 years to see this conference coming to this stage now. All right, as you may be aware, IES, Industrial Electronics Society, it is one of the fastest and progressive society, thanks to very energetic people working in it, like Marek, for example, as a good example. We have also women in engineering, we have students, branch chapters, coordinators, we have a champion for membership, looking after chapters. You will be happy to know that our chapters across the world has grown from 60 to 94 now, within 4 years only. And also our students branch chapter grown from 12 to 34 within the same period also. So we are growing. More importantly, we are a member-based society. So we would like to reach out to you and support you wherever you are. Even if you don't come to our conferences, we love to support you in your college, we love to support you in university, and we love to support you through a well-established mechanism. And this mechanism is students' branch chapters. If you are a student and you would like to have a students' branch chapter, you can contact Marek or contact myself, and then we'll help you for the establishment of your students' branch chapter. We, under normal circumstances, where students travel, we support them for travel for conferences, as based on merits, of course. And we are multinational society. We are the most international society nearly in IEEE. The majority of our membership are from outside USA. So, and I would like to take this opportunity to thank you, Marek, specifically for giving me this opportunity to speak to the students. And also, I would love to offer the students a small token. Actually, it's a big one, which is a free membership of IES if you are already a member of IEEE, but you haven't got your IES membership. We'd like to take this opportunity and offer you a free membership for the rest of the year. Hopefully, you will become member, an active member like Marek, like myself, like everyone else, because our focus, as you can see it in my in the screen, it is join IEEE to advance your career and advance the world at the same time. Thank you very much, Marek, for this brief talk, and I welcome you everyone into this wonderful session that we have it in all our conferences, and thanks to Marek again for this activity.
Thank you very much, Mr. President, for this short introduction of our society. I would like to stress that the issue in power electronics is a processing with the energy. So we have a lot of energetic people today. I would like to introduce another chairperson of this session, Pan Paweł Lasek from Poland, from Gliwice. He is very energetic, young person. He will lead this event. And to be honest, because of him, we have this event today. And of course, because of Mariusz Stępień, General Chair, and some discussion with Pavol Bauer. Okay, another chairman is Professor Marcin Kasprzyk from Poland. He is also from Salesian University in Gliwice. And we will trying to lead the session. And let's start with the keynote speaker, Anton Rassolkin from Tallinn. He is excellent researcher, very young researcher. However, his experience is quite rich. He finished already his PhD, bachelor and master with Taltech in Tallinn. Then he finished engineering science in Germany. He has a lot of experience in industry. So this is excellent example how to join academia and industry experiences. And hopefully Anton will share us some thought about this. He has also international cooperation with ICAM in Germany, ITMO in Russia, excuse me, and with Poland, Gliwice. Mariusz mentioned that you are a very big friend of Salesian University, so thank you very much for this cooperation. I met Anton several times at the conferences. He's a very energetic researcher. He's a specialist in mechatronics and electrical drives, and he is doing his duties at the professor position at Tallinn University of Technology. Anton, you have a floor if you are with us.
Yeah, I'm here.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Marek. It's nice to see you. It's sad that it's online, but still. Thank you for a nice introduction. I'm glad to use this opportunity to share some ideas about ongoing projects and the topic that I will present today. It's called the possibility of digital twins technology for application in propulsion electric and drive. I didn't expect that so great presentation of myself from Marek. Thanks for doing this. So I prepared this slide, but then I will go to the outline of my presentation. So I will briefly present you the idea of digital twin, its connection to the today's industry. We'll discuss a couple of things about Industry 3.0 and Industry 4.0 and the needs of these digital twins. Then I would like to share you the idea about the implementation and different steps in implementation of digital twins. I will show you some examples of application, and in the end I will share the case studies, some interesting case studies that I found on IEEE database, on other journals, and also I will definitely share you some research results of our ongoing project on this topic. So let's go to the industry. Let's see how the today's industry is done. So we see that this is one of the possible representations of Industry 3.0. This called sometimes as old world, but this is actually what we use nowadays. We see that electric drives and power electronics and all the systems are spreadly used here in every part of this representation. We see how it comes from the top of the pyramid and goes more deeply into products. It goes more deeply into the field, how we use. Yes, the Industry 3.0 works properly nowadays. It is used in everywhere, in almost every country. There is a lot of ideas. There is a lot of benefits of using this system. Definitely the using of the hardware that we see, and electrical drives as a hardware, one part, one main part of this hardware, is most important part. So the functions are bounded to the hardware. The system is all it is hierarchy based. So we are going from the enterprise, we are going down to the product. And what is special in such representation, that the product here is isolated. So basically, when the company making the product, when they are providing this product to the customer, final customer, very often they are not getting feedback all the time. They are giving the feedback only if, or they're getting feedback only if the customer saying them, or just some ideas about it. If you will look on the representation of new world industry of the Industry 4.0, we see basically the same application of electrical drives in this area. So we see that all the main hardware steps, they are still on the same, in the same system. We are still using the same factories. We are producing the same products. But the difference is so that everything now is connected to each other. We have more flexible systems that can be connected and interconnected to each other. It can be connected to the machine. We have the functions that those systems and machines are providing, and those services that are providing through the network. So we can connect customers to some support. We can connect customers to each other, and so on. There is some interconnections that are actually across this hierarchy levels that we saw on the previous slide. So we basically can connect directly our product, for example, vehicle, to the system or to some of the components. We can get more information about what is happening in the real life. And what is important, that the product now is a part of the network and it's communicating to all the devices, or it's communicating among the devices or participants of this system. So the main idea of this industry 4.0 is that all of the devices are interconnected. They have, they are working together, and some new features should be definitely added based on this, what we have nowadays. If we are going to the idea about the digital twins, so what is this, how it is done? The digital twin is only one part of the digitalization simulation pillar of Industry 4.0. It is a tool that can help us to integrate into this system. The functions of the digital twin, they can be very different. They can help us to understand the current state of the system. They can understand us, or they can help us to predict something in this system. They can provide us information about the optimization and updates that we require to the system. What is then the digital twin? The digital twin is definitely kind of virtual model. It is some kind of representation. But what is very important in the case of digital twin, that this representation is continuously updated. This virtual copy is always in contact with the real device. And due to that, we can get an idea about the current state of the system, about the possibilities, what can be done in another way. We can also make some predictions. So we can involve this into the more deeply into the system, and we can try to predict maybe failures. We can try to predict the better optimization conditions. And definitely such tool may be used in every part of the industry. And we are not talking about the production. It can be also used in the energy production. It can be used in the energy consumption. It can be used everywhere. So let's try to get more deeply and try to understand what is a digital twin, what is the concept of the digital twin. Most of the research works that done till now on the topic of the digital twin, they represent the digital twin as a five-dimensional system with three main components. First of the main components is the real physical entity. So this is a device that we would like to represent as a digital twin, as a digital copy. In my case, I use a picture of our self-driving bus. So this is a self-driving bus called this auto that we developed in our university. This was a huge project involving a lot of students. Basically, I will say that mostly students were the main active participants for developing this device. There was only four of us from the university. So this fits very well the young specialists and idea. So I use this picture as a tool, as a representation of the system that we would like to create. Besides this real physical entity, we definitely will have a virtual entity. So this is a set of different models. This is a set of different representation of the vehicle, of the propulsion drive of the vehicle. inside this virtual entity, we can have many different representations, starting from the spatial model, how it looks like, how it's changing behavior, how it's changing the position, location, dislocation, so on, till to the behavior models. And also we need to take into account all those physical models, all those what we have in electrical engineering, thermal conditions and so on. And we also have a possibility to study and understand the historical data sets and make maybe some models, make some representation based on those historical data sets. So the data is the third main component of this part. So basically what we have here the physical device. It is a virtual representation as models and the data between them. So they we can exchange the data from one entity to another entity and between the entities. Moreover, this five-dimensional representation includes also connections and includes services. Connections are very important in the case of how we communicate, when we communicate, what data should we store based on the physical entity, what data should we store based on the virtual entity, how we can use data created by the virtual entity for the physical entity, how we can use data from the physical entity to the virtual entity. So these things definitely should work together. Next very important part is definitely services. Okay, we have the data, but what we are doing with this data, how we are applying this, what is our idea of using this data for this physical entity. And so this is also one of the important parts, and definitely this is how this digital twin, how the concept of the digital twin may affect on the today's industry. So this is the most important part from the point of view of the services that we provide and the features, how we use those digital twins. We can use digital twin in many different ways. The very good example is try to understand on the life cycle of the device. So if we are talking about any product that we are using, any device that we are using, we have several steps that are actually also standardized by the International Electrotechnical Commission. So it is mentioned in IEC standard. And each of these steps may be improved. Each of the steps may be somehow extended by the application of the digital twins. To more deeply understand, let's see what we have in each step separately. In the development stage, when we are creating the product, we need to take into account a lot of construction things, a lot of things related to design, to the development. We are doing here a lot of simulations and we are trying to optimize our system. So this is a stage when we are using a lot the models. So those models that we were just talking before, those virtual representation, and they are very different models. Definitely, if those models can be connected to the real devices or to the real prototype, we can get more and more information about the real prototype, about the behavior of this real prototype. The next stage is the general idea, it's maintenance and usage, but actually it is a post-development. So we created the product and we are going to the level that we are improving our product for the customers. We are creating some software updates. We are preparing some manuals. We are trying to find what can be a better maintenance cycles and so on. So we are trying to prepare this product for the customer. And this is also the option when we can use it digital twins. We can use some accelerated life cycle tests. We can use some real studies, real simulations. And this, how this digital twin can contribute. Then we are going to production stage. On the production stage, you will usually take care about the product itself, and we also need to somehow track these products. We need somehow to follow the data we produce. We need to follow those serial numbers. So this is actually how we are trying to understand where our products are located. Maybe this feature will also allow us to give more wide representation about the idea of how we can improve one or another thing. I mean, here we are talking on this conference, we're talking a lot about the power electronic devices, about drives. One thing when our electrical drive will work in somewhere in Africa, and another thing when it will be work in North Pole, because the environmental conditions are very different. And maybe some software changes will require. So this kind of things will help us to track and to understand the system, how it's used. Definitely, when it's the product comes to the final user, we have a lot of information to receive from the final user. If we would like to improve this product, if we would like to make it better and to make it more attractive for the user. So we need to provide some services, we need to provide maintenance. After the usage phase, we need to think about the recycling, we need to think about the parts of those product, maybe it can be reused somehow. And so all this information actually required some additional digitalization, it is required some digital representations. And the digital twin can provide us these things. So we have the cycle the cycle of the product where we are trying to integrate our digital twin. Definitely, there will be pros and cons. There will be some advantages and different disadvantages. With development stage, we can try to model different approaches, and we can try to see how the cross domains are related to each other in one digital twin, in one representation. At the same time, the conditions, to the real conditions, may be very different. So we definitely need to take this into account during this development and application of this digital twin to this stage. In case of preparing or post-development stage, we can try to use our visualization, our virtual things a lot for the different ways, but we need to be really careful about the proper data. Is the data that we are receiving really the data from the real environment? Is it behavior, is it real or not? On the production stage, we can definitely, yes, get a better understanding of the line. Of the production line, we can be better understanding of the system. We can make maybe some good decisions on our devices, but the cost of such thing may be very high, and some of the products on our market doesn't require this so big things like this digital twins. We would like, yes, to get this feedback from the customers, but at the same time, it may be sometimes will be different, difficult to understand. It will be difficult to interpret and difficult to apply this feedback. So the idea of this digital twin must allow us to make all of these steps in our product life cycle more like better, more understandable, and we can, we need to get information about every stage and understand how we can use this information. Just to show, just to maybe visualize this different stages, I have prepared some couple of examples about the digital twin implementation. And on the development stage, we definitely can use this for the representing the product. We can prepare it for maybe some tuning and for preparing for some system. One very interesting example from the PTC is using of the digital twin in development of the bicycle. So you can see that using the augmented reality, we can see how the forces are affecting on the bike, how the systems should be tuned and should be improved. Definitely using of such system for the bike that I use every day to go for a walk to the park or going to the work, it's not so important. But if we were talking about the bikes that you, the professional sportsmen are using, for them, this is maybe very important, because by proper optimization, by proper tuning, they can reach new records and they can beat the new, the old records. So in some, let's say, applications, this can be very, very important, very valuable. In optimization, it is also important. So we can use the digital twin to optimize the idea, to optimize the structure. I have one very interesting example on the factory, but this optimization can be also used for the many systems, because in every devices that we are working on, we have different energies used in there. We have different combinations of users. So this is just a representation. This is just a way how to show you, but I hope you will get the idea and you will try to use this same thing for the other devices and some maybe more small processes. So you mentioned that we have a factory, and in the factory, we have a lot of different units. So we have the staff, we have the bosses, we have here manufacturing, we have vehicles, computers, buildings, whatever. And we are collecting the data from the real factory. Collecting data from real factory, storing them in some place, and trying to create the digital twin of this factory to understand how this data for interconnection of all this very different parts. It can be also electrical energy, it can be also mechanical energy, it can be everything here. How it can, how it works. We are simulating each of these components one by one, and then we are providing the co-simulation of this component. If we have the co-simulation, we understand when the one or another part of the big system of this big factory working more precisely, what is the most efficient part of this system. Based on this, we are creating the list of advices, we can creating the list of the optimization technology, and then we start to synchronize the real factory. And we try starting to create the system that will be optimized based on our digital representation. So this is how we can improve the system. That's what we can do not only with a factory, but any devices we want, starting from power converter and ending with electrical vehicle. Definitely a very important part is the maintenance of our devices. We know that there are several types of the maintenances. And the most common thing in the world is the corrective maintenance, is when the device is working, then performance is starting to getting down, and then one time it's breaks, so we need to replace, we need to change it. We cannot use it anymore. To somehow improve this, we know that we can use preventive maintenance. So that's what we are always doing with our vehicles, with our cars. If I'm driving my car and see that some of the signals are blinking, says it's saying me that we need to change something, or I need to change the oil or put the gas, I'm going to repair it, and I can extend the lifetime, and I can use this more longer, this device. We can use also the predictive maintenance. This is some features that can help us. They can see us when it could be broken or it's starting to get worse, so do something. For this predictive maintenance, the digital twin is actually a perfect solution, because it will show us how to use it, how to prepare it, and how we can use it in case of the system utilization. Definitely, the predictive maintenance is a way of the condition monitoring of any device that can be used online, and it must be used online. So we need to get the information about the system. The corrective and preventive maintenances, those are the monitoring, condition monitoring types that are usually used offline, but at the same time, they are very promising, and sometimes we are getting more information about them when we are using those already our experience, already our offline condition monitoring phase. And digital twin can help us to move those things into online prediction. So basically, what I'm trying to say that we know that how the condition monitoring may be used in the case of electrical engineering, in the case of the electrical equipment. We're using different IE-based approaches, like neural networks, fuzzy logic, and so on. We're using a lot of ways how to detect the faults, like motor current signature analysis, fast Fourier transform, valve transforms, and so on. But the digital twin, the simulating those things in parallel with physical devices, it can allow us to do it online, and it can bring us new features for this. What is also good in the case of the digital twins is that we can use virtual sensors. So we can use some specific connections between those models and some parts that we are not really simulating. I'm sure that you all know the software ANSYS for the FEM simulation, for the FEM modeling. We use it in many different ways. We use it for the mechanical models. We use it for electromagnetic models. So what we can do nowadays, even ANSYS already, they are implementing the idea of the virtual sensor. And the virtual sensor, in the case of this example on the slide, is a thermal sensor. So we're basically trying to understand what are the hot spots on our electrical machine. And by using those FEM simulations, we can easily do it. And it can definitely help us to understand how our device is working and how it's operating. So if we look on the digital twins, we have basically two ways how to do it. It is a physical-based digital twin or data-driven digital twin. Physical-based digital twin, it is more about the equations, it's more about the physical models, and data-driven, it is more about the IE, it's more about the data understanding, data collecting. In the real life, in the real cases of digital twins, we are combining those parts. We are combining them, and we are trying to get the better parts from the physics-based digital twins and the data-driven digital twins. What do we need for the digital twin? Okay, I'm talking a lot about the idea, about the concept. But first of all, In our everyday life, it is very important to show, to represent, and to simulate these things. So definitely we need to have some simulation environment, simulation toolkit. Nowadays it can be MATLAB, ANSYS, or some other software. Very important to show, to represent, to visualize these digital twins. So and for industry, because visualization in this case is very important, because users, the people who working with those digital twins, they may be not so big specialist as a developer of the digital twin. So he need to understand in some way of what he should do, what he should change in the system. So it's very important to create a representation. And in nowadays in industry, a lot of industrial avatars are used, and you see there is a different software for mixed and advanced and augmented reality I used. And some of them are actually the video games that we are, some of us playing a lot. So in the industry, they call serious games. So those are the same engines for the visualization. And one more important thing of the digital twin, it is middleware. So it is a way how we need to connect the services, how we need to connect the physical device to the real world. Nowadays, there are many different ways how to do it. What is used a lot in the universities, in the research societies, and also in the industry, it is a ROS or robot operation system. So it is middleware to connect those things. But more common for us, it is some operation systems like Windows, Android, and so on. Idea is so that, for example, we have on our mobile phone the camera that is a physical device, and we have the software that start this camera. So this Android providing this communication. So this communication from a button on the user interface on the application to the device is very important. And we can definitely use it in many different applications. We can use it in many different systems. And here you see many different applications where the digital twins may be implemented. And I have highlighted some parts that in my opinion may be related to the electrical drives, to the power electronics, but actually to the normal, to the electronics, but actually we see that it is almost everywhere where we can implement it. Now I would like to show you some case studies and some ideas. The first video that I will show, it's about the work that have been done in our university by my colleagues. And this is a representation of the digital twin of the industrial robotic system. So you can see a student who is controlling the robotic manipulator from the virtual environment. So he has VR glasses, and you see those green dots. It's actually the control signals for the robot system. But what is he's doing in the virtual world is going to the real life. So basically, he is connecting this robot from the virtual environment. This is a case study. This is an experiment, how we can use it. What this is example, but definitely it may find a lot of interesting applications. One case study from the real world related to the propulsion drives and related to the vehicles is the Kamaz truck. So you definitely know those trucks from the competitions, from the Dakar competitions where they're using. So they are the company trying to create the digital twin of its truck. And you see it is getting a lot of data about the system and analyzing this, restructure it and try to understand how this virtual data, how this digital twin will work with a real truck, because the trucks from the Kamaz, they work in the very harsh environment. They work in very hard conditions in the Dakar where they are providing this competition. And for example, if there will be some smoke in the inside the cabin of this track, where the smoke is coming? Is it coming from the engine? It is coming from some mechanical part, it is coming from the electrical motor, or maybe it's just a driver want to smoke. So this digital twin may give an information for the people who are trying to provide the better services for such tracks. And then definitely such tracks may be used not only in competitions, but also for the logistics. We know that the logistics nowadays is very important part of our lives, of the tracking of the system and so on. Our current area, our research projects at the moment is related to the our self-driving bus. Here on the video, you can see the virtual representation of this bus. Actually, we created this vision when we just started to create our bus, because you see the video was done as a normal video, so we recorded it from the drone, but we put it the virtual representation of the bus into this world, into the real video, and try to visualize how it would be in the in few years. Later, if you will, if you have more interest, you can go to the link and see how it was done, what it was created. You can also Google for result or just check in the YouTube. You will see a lot of videos about the development and the tuning of the systems. But our project, what we have at the moment, that called Digital Twin for Propulsion Drive on Autonomous Electrical Vehicle, is a project related to propulsion system. So we are taking the electrical drive, the main drive that push this vehicle, and we're trying to create the digital twin and provide some services. This project is started around a year ago, so we're just making some first steps. We have presented this in the several conferences, the results, so you can also Google or you can find them on the IEEE Explore and other platforms. But I would like to show you some ideas, some achievements that we got. One of the idea, we would like to use a regular induction machine as a loading motor to load the drive of this autonomous vehicle. So because we have tested a lot of those drives and we got at the efficiency map, we decided to build the digital twin that is based on the data that we received from the motor that has a virtual representation of this system. And the first idea, the first step what we have done, it was the creating of the virtual representation that actually changed behavior based on the working point, based on the point where we are locating, where we, our system is located. So what we are doing here, based on the data collected from the motor, we can represent it as a virtual thing and it start to work. So you can see here the torque arrow and the speed arrow, so it's starting to change. The similar, in the similar way, we are preparing the step-by-step the parts of this full drive system. So here it is an example of the similar representation for the reduction gear of the vehicle. So there is a reduction gear 6:1 that connects electrical motor to the transmission. And this how we can use, and we know that reduction gear, it has also its own efficiency map and it's have its own limits. So this is how we are, what we are doing here. What is the services? What is the ideas? How we can use this representation maybe for more detailed services or for more services that are dedicated for some specific application. Here you see the video, how the digital twin is working. You see the on the left top corner, the test bench, and we are trying to simulate the short circuit, intern, inter-turn short circuit or one of the motor, you see how on the data acquisition system, the currents are rising. You see how the robot operation system reacts on this. It sent the warning because the current is not so high, but it still sends the warnings about the what is wrong with this. And then you see the representation, the visual representation of the system. And you see that one of the phases, one of the three phases, it changed the current slightly. So it's already, it's not that bad current for electrical motor. It is the current that not very dangerous, but still it is not normal current. So the virtual representation is starting to show in which phase and how big this current. If the current will go higher, so if the short circuit will be more higher, bigger, then it will change color to the red. So the person who is operating, who is working with this representation, he will understand that here is trouble in the winding. So that's how those services can help and can provide some additional services for those devices. So talking about the digital twins, talking about the idea. So I just show you small case studies, but the thing is that this is a field that is now developing. So we cannot say that we are ready for use. We are ready using this digital twin in very good manner. No, we are trying to find new horizons. We're trying to find new applications. How the digital twins can be used and what they can be used for. Definitely they can reduce maintenance costs. So if you have the presentation, if we know when and what will be broken in the system, we can get the idea about very fast about the maintenance and about the repairing of this equipment. We can try to use optimal operation modes. We can try to keep this optimal operation modes regarding to maybe some failures and so on. We can increase visibility and we can show it more precisely for the people who is working this. We can reduce time to market. We can try to optimize, we can try to reduce energy consumption. We can try to increase the user engagement. So we can show to the user how he uses it, how he operates with this, what is doing.
Anton, sorry, 3 minutes left.
Perfect, because this is my last slide.
Excellent.
Thanks, Marek. So what I want to say in the end, there is no perfect digital twin. So we have a different representation, we have different copies, but then there is a lot of them. There is actually quite a long way to do. We have a lot of things to develop. We can, we need to develop the IT technologies. We need to develop our real physical things in better manner, how to connect them together. We definitely need to know how to integrate this into the digital twin. We need to take into account all the labor, all the persons that will be included in this development, because in this way, you see that now we are talking not only about the electrical or mechanical engineering, but we are talking also about the electrical mechanical engineering related to the IT. And so we need to think about if we are developing new thing, how it will be connected in the future. Definitely it will be a great competition in data analysis, because the amount of the data is very big, and this will be definitely a challenge of the such ideas, digital twins. And that's it. Thank you for the attention. So,
thank you very much. Very interesting presentation. However, I have a slight a delay. I have the information from the conference organizer that we have finished on time. That's why I propose to write the question on the chat and move the discussion after the competition, if all of you agree. Pavel, is it a good idea?
Yes, I guess that's a good idea. We still need to run all the videos. We currently have like 12 videos to play, and we have to make a voting in between. And that will take like 50 minutes, I believe, for everything.
So when we can use the voting time for the questions and answers.
Yes, Anton, do you have an access to the chat? Because on the chat we have the questions, you can chat with the questionnaires. Yes. Nomar already submitted the question. Try to write the answer on the chat.
Okay, yes.
Thank you.
Okay. So, hello once again. My name is Pavel Lasek, and I was set in charge of conducting the competition during the conference. And I would like to make a gentle introduction to what is going to happen in next couple of minutes, and so that you will be all familiar with what will be going on in between. So during the conference, we've prepared like two different kinds of competitions. First competition was dedicated to the best paper competition. And this is a competition that's still going on because there are two parts to it. First part is that currently we are in the process of voting by the chairs the presented papers during the conference. And I'm saying currently because after this session, there will be another parallel sessions that during which there will be a voting still. So we are still waiting for the voting from the chairs. Another thing is that some people wanted to participate in this competition. And the rules were set by the standards of 3 minutes video. During the sessions, regular sessions, people were presenting their research in like 10, 15 minutes. But this competition was set in order to boil down these papers, these researches, whatever, to the 3 minute videos. So they had to present their work in much shorter amount of time. That's one thing. And the second thing was that they had to make a few, let's say, casual introductions to the topic so that it's friendly for the people, for the listeners, and so on. And the second part of this competition was the competition for the best ambassador of power electronics and motion control. And this is another competition that was kind of surprised the participants. And it also has two parts, but on that later. So firstly, let's move to the best paper competition. As you can see, we've obtained 6 videos. The last video prepared by Michał Adamczyk was set in the last minute, and currently we are working with the IES staff that is responsible for the IES YouTube channel to upload the video. And he is still participating in this event. So during this, we will be running all 6 videos. I will be talking, maybe telling you the titles of the papers that are referred to all these videos. And after all these 6 videos, we'll run the voting system. And all the people that are currently present at this session are welcome to give their votes. The voting system is set in such a way that you can vote on multiple videos, whichever you like. So maybe some people liked only one video and maybe some people liked all the videos. So we'll be taking up votes. We will wait until the steady state and we will see the results live. Then we will move to the other session and so on and so on. So I believe it should take around 50 minutes for everything to set up. So let's move to the first video. And I hope everything works fine because some of the videos are played online and I will be streaming from YouTube to the YouTube because this session is still online. Okay, so let's run this video.
Is there any voice? We couldn't hear the voice.
Please share the sound.
Okay, that was the first video. Let's move to the next one. In the order that we are playing the videos, the voting system will be set in that exact order. So that was a video prepared by Noman Shabir. The title was Optimal Fractional Order PI Controller for Field-Oriented Current Controller of switched reluctance motor. Now let's move to the second video titled Identification of Mechanical Parameters in Servo Drive Systems by Rafał Szczepański from Poland. Okay, let's move to another video then.
The basic elements in the servo drive systems are spring, friction, and moment of inertia. The friction can be modeled as a viscous friction, as a viscous friction and a column friction, and with the viscous friction, column friction, and the strip-x effect. Our laboratory stand is equipped in two additional rotating discs, which provide an additional moment of inertia, and they are connected with the bearings and couplings. The data set for the identification process is obtained by generated steps of the electromagnetic torque by our motor. Next, the collated data are used to obtain the mechanical parameters of the servo drive system. The proposed identification method used the nature-inspired optimization algorithm to provide the optimal nonlinear mechanical model and its use to minimize the difference between the experimental angular velocity and the model angular velocity. The obtained results are presented in a graphical form of the fitness to the real experiment, in graphical form of the friction, and in the table with the obtained parameters and with the normalized root mean square error indicator. The moment of inertia is changed using a mechatronic device. And the obtained results for the increased moment of inertia are presented in the same form as previously. The conclusions are as follows. An application of the proposed method allows to obtain the superior fitness to the dataset. The proposed identification method allows to extend model by any nonlinear part, for example a Strebex effect, which is not possible in the well-known methods. Obtained model by the proposed method provides higher normalized root mean square error and better fitness to dataset than other methods.
Okay, so that was the second paper. Now let's move to the third one, which is titled Heat Pump Induction Motor Faults Caused by Soft Starter Topology, a case study prepared by Karolina Kudelina.
Electrical machines. Firstly, it might sound like something very engineering, but in reality, people are using electrical machines every day. Besides, electrical machines are playing an essential role in different industries and applications. Due to the wide usage of such devices, the maintenance and reliability is getting a great importance. Otherwise, it can be. During the operation of electrical machine, different stresses can affect it. It is also clear that nothing is eternal and every machine breaks down at some point. Generally, these faults can be classified into three main groups: stator, rotor, and bearing-related faults. Of course, the distribution of these faults mainly depends on motor parameters, such as type of the machine, size, rated voltage, and so on. Even if the global parameters of electrical machine meet defined values, visually, there can be detected some imperfections. In this case, even very small imperfection and damages can lead to negative consequences. To provide a reliable operation of the machine, many parameters must be monitored at the same time. The shelter-based condition monitoring could be useful, but it doesn't give us a lot of information about the remaining lifetime of the device. Moreover, in production, it usually means a partial or total shutdown of manufacturing processes, which means inefficient resource usage and extra operating costs. To decrease shutdown cost and minimize downtime, manufacturers switch their production over predictive maintenance. For us, all the studied cases, such as heat pump damages, can help to develop a fault model and use it for predictive maintenance that allows to forecast a future failure. And this, in turn, will help to avoid negative consequences in general and make production more reliable and safer.
Okay, that was the video. Now let's move to the fourth one, which is titled IoT-based tool for data acquisition in electrical machines and robotics, prepared by Hadi Ashraf Raja.
With the revolutionization of industry recently, researchers are trying to automate more of the industry processes and equipment to make them more efficient and reliable. A big part of this revolution is Internet of Things, which enables devices to communicate with each other independently. This is an industrial example of Internet of Things. In this example, we are considering a network connected to windmill. Here data is being gathered from windmills using sensor and then transmitted to a central control center, where further analysis is being done on the retrieved data and a comprehensive overview is shown to the technician. This allows the technician to not only reduce cost for maintenance but also the time taken to fix a specific fault. This is the general overview of the workflow of setup from data acquisition point to central control center.
Okay, that was the fourth video. Now let's move to the fifth video. A global path planning for mobile robot based on artificial bee colony and Dijkstra algorithm, prepared once again by Rafał Szczepański.
Nowadays, the robotization process in modern industry factories is very advanced.
the cooperation between robots and humans in these factories is common. The proposed method is divided into two parts. First one is the offline part, which is responsible to optimize the path for each analyzed workspace. We want to also minimize the control points of the path in the optimization, and after this part, we have the generated optimal path points for the online part of the algorithm. After that, the online part is implemented in the robot, and we create a graph with the proper connection costs, including the created optimal path points by the offline part. We add to the graph also the start position, which is a robot position, and destination position. After that, we use the Dijkstra's algorithm to find the shortest path in the graph. In most cases, the generated path is the optimal one. On the other hand, even if the robot does not provide the optimal trajectory, I would say it's a quite satisfactory solution. It should be mentioned that there is a simple additional remark that if a robot is in the violation area of the worker, it stops due to the safety reasons, and after it goes aft out of the violation area of the worker, it starts the trajectory. From this point, he stopped.
That was quite unexpected. That took me by surprise. Okay, let's move to the last presentation then. Which is titled Current Sensor for Detection and Tolerant Control for Induction Motor Drive, prepared by Michał Adamczyk. And we hope that soon after this session, the video will be available on IEEE's YouTube channel.
Drive systems with AC motors are more and more popular. We meet them everywhere, not only in factories, but also trams or electric cars, airplanes, etc. For this reason, it is very important that such systems are safe and allow to maintain continuous work, even if some faults occurs. Because the stator current measurement is necessary for precise control of the AC drive system, current sensor fault tolerant control are increasing popularity in the recent years. However, this issue requires many scientific research related to the fault detection and compensation methods, as well as to ensure the most accurate estimation of the stator current under fault condition to preserve the continuous operation of the drive till it can be safely stopped. In the presented operation, a stator current estimator called virtual current sensor has been proposed, which allows fast detection of a faulty sensor and a smooth transition to the control in emergency mode. In case of the outage of both current sensors in the drive, it enables the current sensorless mode operation. As it is seen, the rotor speed is stabilized properly, despite the first of two current sensor fault, and next when the drive system operates in current sensorless mode. The rotor flux is stabilized all the time despite the damages of the consecutive current sensors. The tests were carried out for two different order of faults, first current sensor in phase A and next current sensor in phase B, and vice versa shown in the paper. The fault occurred in the steady state and, as can be seen here, epsilon coefficients very quickly exceed the threshold value, established in both cases at 0.1. This allows very fast current sensor fault detection in phase A and next in phase B. Because of this, the alpha-beta components of the stator current is maintained by proposed virtual current sensor algorithm despite the fault of both sensors. My name is Michał Adamczyk, I am from the Department of Electrical Machines, Drives and Measurements at Wrocław University of Science and Technology, and this is area of my PhD studies.
Okay, now we've seen all videos.
Drive.
Now let's move to the voting first. So I will stop sharing the screen and let's open the voting system. Give me a second. Okay, now if you are seeing me on the screen, and you probably should, I should be visible on the smaller screen with a voting system in place. And if you join the link, which I will post just in case in the chat for everyone, you can join the voting and give your vote to your favorite paper. Okay, now I should be visible. We can see the votes coming up. If you still have any questions to Professor Anton Rassolkin, please feel free to ask him anything about his presentation. During this time, we'll be waiting until we reach steady state in votes. Please also remember that the participants had like a little less than a week to prepare the videos. And of course it was in between the conference. So it was awesome to see the videos prepared so well. We will wait a couple of seconds to see the results.
I'm sorry, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
So you have already said that we have seen all the videos, but you haven't shown our video. But yesterday you said that it was not bad, and
you've misunderstood something. These were the videos prepared by the presenters of the conference for something different, and now we will move to your videos. Don't worry about it.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, it seems that we've reached steady state. Let's maybe reveal the numbers. So give me a second. Okay, 1, 2, 3. Okay, and the winner is C, Karolina Kudelina, with paper titled Heat Pump Induction Motor Faults Caused by Soft Starter Topology Case Study. The second place belongs to the F position, Michał Adamczyk, with paper titled Current Sensor Fault Detection and Tolerant Control for Induction Motor Drive. And the first place belongs to the Rafał Szczepański, with paper titled Global Path Planning for Mobile Robot Based on Artificial Bee Colony and Dijkstra Algorithms. So congratulations to the winners of this part of the competition. We'll be having additional voting going on after the session F, which is a parallel session during which there might be some papers which were included in this competition that will be additionally voted on, and we will get all the results and we will inform all the participants about those that are on the podium who wins what. I would like to thank you to all the participants in this part of the competition. Feel free to contact us. Please send us your addresses. We've prepared some goods that we will send, some prizes for all the winners of this competition, this part. And additionally, as we said, we've also prepared some other prizes that refer to maybe Professor Marek Jasiński would like to tell us more about the possible prizes that the winners of this competition might have won.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you very much for very interesting videos and excellent atmosphere. So we have ES student paper and travel assistance to offer. So this is the diploma and travel and paper publication at the conference, cost reimbursement for the authors that have won the competition.
Okay, thank you. So you'll get some compensation. Okay, now let's move to the other part of this competition, which is a little bit different than what we have seen this time. Let me switch to my face, maybe. Okay, the other part of the competition was, let's say, a little bit of a surprise to everyone. And it was divided into two parts. And the first part was set for the group of undergraduate students, which were invited to the conference, and they were asked to prepare a video, as well as the second group, which is the group of graduates and professionals working in the industry that are also part of the students and young professionals, and they meet all the conditions to be a young professional. And there was a common theme for all these groups, and the theme was, how would you encourage and inspire young people to progress towards studying industrial electronics and related subjects? So, you know, we are all electrical engineers. We studied, we do it this is our job, basically. And the there's a this period of the time of the year where people are applying for the universities. And we thought that, hey, how do we inspire, how do we get more people to study electrical engineering in the first place? So we've asked this question to our students, to the graduates, the participants of the of this conference, and we wanted to see their answer to this problem, essentially. So, you know, they've decided to study electrical engineering and they started to do research in electrical engineering. So that's what we're interested in. And the first group that I will be presenting is the group of undergraduate students. And we have three teams that were invited to this competition. The first team is from the Ivano-Frankivsk National Technical University of Oil and Gas from Ukraine. The second team is from the Silesian University of Technology. And the third team is from the Tallinn University of Technology in Estonia. So let's move to the first video prepared by our colleagues from Ukraine.
Good afternoon. May I come in?
Hello. Yes, you may. This is the installation that we are currently working in our department. It is a tracking system for tracking the sun, and it allows us to generate eco-friendly energy. This energy is used to power homes, electric motors, and other appliances and devices.
In this video, we can see our experimental setup. It is a single-axle solar tracker which can follow the movement of the sun and rotate the solar panels to the zone of the greatest luminosity. Thanks to it, our solar panels work more effectively. Solar panels feed the buildings and create micro-network. The circuit contains photoresistors, slight indicators and Arduino board which is programmed according to the appropriate algorithm. Explanation to the electrical circuit. In this project, we use Arduino platform. It allows us to work in two modes. Manual control mode, in which you can set needed energy and conducting research. Automatic mode, in which tracker sets needed energy by itself. The programmed algorithm of the system is quite simple. The microcontroller reads the values from the photoresistors periodically and compares them. If the values are different, the controller commands servo to turn the panel in the needed direction towards greater luminosity.
And use our experience and upgrade yourself with us.
Take and use our experience and upgrade yourself with us.
Okay, we've seen the first video. Now let's move to the second one, prepared by the students of our university from the Silesia, and let's see what they have prepared for us.
Thank you.
Okay, that was the video. Thank you also. Now let's move to the third one, prepared by the team from Tallinn University of Technology. Let's see.
Hello everyone, my name is Daniel Lame, I'm a master's student from Tallinn University of Technology. And today I'd like to introduce you a story of our team. And for that, let's ask the guy over there. There. And to begin with, let's take a look a little back.
No, not this far. Still wrong. Nope. Yes, this is the right one. By the way, it's our mentor, Professor Anton Rassolkin.
I have a challenge for you.
And that's how our BPMC journey started.
Ah, by the way, I forgot to introduce our team. There is four of us.
Stan is education keen. His path to engineering started 20 years ago with Lego. Fred is a coding guru. He knows how to run the code without blue screen. As a kid, he liked garage and motorcycles, so he decided to learn engineering. Dave in our team is a machine vision pro. Also, he knows a lot of stuff about helicopters and airplanes. Hi, I'm Daniel, team lead. I just watched many Iron Man movies as a teenager. Bosch Future Mobility Challenge is an international technical competition created by Bosch. The goal is to develop best autonomous driving algorithms on 1 to 10 scale vehicles. At the beginning, we had almost zero experience with autonomous cars. First of all, we got the car kit from Bosch, played with it, started coding, printed a test track. Fortunately, Professor had a huge printer. Now we learn something new each day. How to stop navigation, how to use machine vision, or what subscriber in ROS is.
You are still here. Let's continue.
As engineers, we see that electronics is in the heart of new technologies. Just take a look on our car. Wires, batteries, resistors, and so on. Actually, you can find electronic components almost everywhere. In radio, in windmill, in smartphone, or even in blender from your kitchen. In case of our project, without basic knowledge in electronics, we won't even be able to drive our car. I mean, without any smoke or sparks.
Electronics is all about the future. That's the main reason why we are so curious about learning both autonomous navigation and electronics. So, see you in the lab.
I hope we'll see sometime. Thank you for the video. Now let's move to the voting. Okay, so let's see. The link, the URL stays the same as last time, but I will have to run the voting system once again. Give me a second, accept. And now you can vote. Okay, we have a clear winner, I guess, but still, let's wait for more votes. For those who had joined us, I will paste the URL on the chat for everyone, so that you can easily access the voting system. We have still some a little bit competition going on for the third and second place. The good thing about having three teams is that everyone will be on podium. Okay, we've had a little bit more this time, but two votes separated for two teams. Okay. Couple of seconds. Let's wait a bit. Okay, something moved. There is still a competition going on. Okay, I guess we've reached steady state. There seems to be no other votes coming in. So let's see who's on which place. Okay, so you see that the first place is a team from Tallinn. The second place belongs to Ivano-Frankivsk National Technical University of Oil and Gas. And the first place belongs to the Silesian University of Technology. It was an honor to see something like this. Please remember also that these were the undergraduate students. They were also caught by surprise to prepare all those videos. They are still students, but I hope that they someday they will become a graduate students, researchers, and they can speak with confidence about the research and about the electrical engineering itself. Okay, so now let's move to the last voting. And this is somehow special, let's say, because for this thing, and we will move to the prizes after this. Okay, so the last part is dedicated to the graduate students. And these graduate students are basically also the participants of this conference. And it was more of a surprise to them than to everyone else because they've marked some boxes during the registration that they want to participate in this event. And they were from different universities. So what do we do about it? And we've decided that the main goal of Student&Young Professional is to enforce a cooperation between different institutions, different people from different institutions, maybe some companies. And we've decided that we will force people to cooperate with one another at random, basically. So we've decided to mix people that were wishing to participate in this kind of event into three teams. Well, we had more, but after hearing what we've decided to give them as a task, some of them decided to cancel their participation and we were left with the three teams only. So what you will see in a short moment was the result of a cooperation between people that possibly didn't know anything about each other, unlike the undergraduate students, and they've also prepared an excellent videos. So let's see and let's watch. Okay, first team. I'm not stating the names over here, but they will be visible on the voting and on the opening screen. Okay, let's move on.
What motivates me is that I can play with all these cool things and make some interesting innovations for the betterment of society. When something works according to your design, it's an amazing feeling. because you have created something with your own hands.
These pictures are from an event that we do every year in our university to encourage young students and children to take engineering subjects. And I think they really help, and we need to do more events to encourage more people.
I was born and grew up in Kermanshah, a beautiful and historical city located in the western part of Iran. In fact, painting and physics have been two inseparable parts of my life. After completing my high school, I felt that mechatronics engineering would be the area which would give me the chance to acquire the knowledge of how the fundamentals of science are employed to create technology and realize my illustrations for practical objectives. My name is Mohammad Jamshidi, a PhD student at the University of West Bohemia in Plzeň, the Czech Republic. My research field is applications of AI in electrical drives, which should be called mechatronic systems. You know, mechatronics is a multidisciplinary field of science, which includes a synergistic combination of electrical engineering, control engineering, computer engineering and mechanical engineering in the design of the products and manufacturing process. You know, as the technology advances, the subfield of engineering multiply and adapt. Mechatronics aim is a design process to unify these subfields. You might be wondering about the wide variety of its applications in high-tech systems, something like automation and robotics, medical imaging systems, aerospace, power electronics, intelligent transportation system, Internet of Things, and many other priceless utilizations.
Okay, that was the video. Now let's move to the next one. Okay. So the next video was prepared by the second team, or team number two, and let's see what they have prepared for us.
My name is Arash Moradi and I'm from Iran. I'm doing my PhD at the School of Information, Technology and Electrical Engineering at the University of Queensland, Brisbane, Australia.
Hello, my name is Ahmed Hibela. I am from Egypt, which is located in North Africa. Right now I work with the University of Nottingham at the Aerospace Technology Center. And my main body of work is in aircraft electrification, which is part of the greater scheme, which is transportation electrification.
My name is Rafał Szczepański, I'm from Poland. I work as an assistant of the Department of Automatics and Measurement System Nicolas Copernicus University in Toruń, and my research interests include adaptive control and path planning algorithms for mobile robots.
In these pictures, you can see only a few instances of motors that we use in our daily life. These motors, just as an example, can be used in an elevator to lift people. But do you know how we can control the speed of this elevator or the smoothness of its movements? Using one of the great applications of power electronics, motor drives. In my PhD, I'm working on these motor drives to make them more efficient and more reliable.
We work with the electromagnetic design of machines and then later on control of this machine through power electronics and different algorithms. And this work would eventually design of electric motors for different applications. For my case, it's aerospace propulsion. And an example of this is this purpose-built alpha electro, which can be sold right now for almost 130,000. And even very more importantly, you can now be part of projects such as the NASA helicopter design, which is basically a design of electric motors with the associated control circuits and power electronics.
So we can provide optimal control for electrical drive. We can build and control custom robots. We can optimize the mobile robots and robotic arms movements. And we can create an awesome custom electronic devices.
Okay, thank you for the video. Now let's move to the third team and see how they wish to encourage people to join electrical engineering. But first I have to close because apparently I cannot open the video itself, the presentation, but it has to be run externally. Okay, let's see the last video.
Oh, good day. I'm Karolina from Tallinn University of Technology, and I study engineering. I work in engineering. Engineering is not that boring like many could think, and let me show you why. Here in our laboratory of electrical machines, we do different things. We design and optimize electrical machines and drive systems. We implement different novel approaches such as digital twin. We are also dealing with diagnostic of electrical machines. For example, me, I learn intelligent condition monitoring methods and how to implement artificial intelligence into diagnostics to ensure innovative and secure future. And this is only a small part of everything we call engineering. Engineers create amazing things. Now let's see what's doing Amir from University of Queensland in Australia.
Hey guys, this is Amir here. I study PhD in power electronics at the University of Queensland in Australia. Here I want to show you very briefly our facilities in power electronics lab known as Green Lab at the University of Queensland. Here you could see the motor drive systems. You could see a lot of drives here. Actually, my PhD project is a kind of industrial based project which is based in Denmark. And we are collaborating with Danfoss Drives, which is a very reputed company in the Europe. And we've got grid simulators as well. Actually, we are actually analyzing the electromagnetic interference or actually harmonic emissions in the motor drive system. So through this grid simulator, we inject harmonics.
And what about Muhammad from Chuseok University in South Korea?
Hello guys, my name is Muhammad Usama. I'm working in Power Conversion Lab in Chuseok University, and my major is working on the motor drive control. And what motivates me to work in this field is the application of the drives in different industrial applications like electric vehicles, or we have robotics, mechatronics, and many others. We are working on designing the control boards and control algorithms, especially motor drives and the converters. And we have, so far we did a lot of different projects with national and industrial associations.
Okay, that was the end of the video. Now let's move to the last voting and give me a second. Okay. And the voting should start now. So we are accepting the votes. We already have 2, 5. Okay. The voting is moving. Let's wait a bit. Okay, now we're having a bit of a fight for the first and second place. It's close. Who knows what might happen? Okay. The one of the teams is leading with a 3 votes. Do you feel those emotions, you know, this tension? Okay. Something happened there. Just a few seconds. It seems like we are reaching steady state. Okay, maybe I will reveal the answers. Okay, 1, 2, 3. And the winner is Karolina Kudelina with Amir Kajavi and Muhammad Usama. Congratulations. The second place belongs to the team number 2, which is Arash Morandi, Ahmed Hebala, and Rafał Szczepański. And the first place belongs to the team number 1, Noman Shabir and Mohamed Baghdad Jamishid. Congratulations to everyone. Thank you for participating in this competition. And getting back to the prizes for both groups, both undergraduates and the graduates, I believe we have prepared very similar things for all the participants in this competition. So maybe Professor Marek Jasiński can support us with the information about the prizes. You're muted. Okay.
It's strange. Sorry.
No problem.
Now, do you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Sorry. Very interesting and exciting presentations. And to be honest, this is an excellent form to publish on YouTube. I would like to propose the special diploma from Industrial Electronics Society, and I will try to propose the same award as a student paper and travel assistance, but this has to be discussed with relation with your paper.
Yeah, please remember that the second group, the graduates, were also the participants of the conference, and we can include something more related to the conference. Definitely. But in case of the undergraduates who are regular students and were not participating, except one maybe, because I know that the Hrihori Stachiv was also a participant of the conference, and we can do a little bit less, but let's be honest, we still will prepare some prizes for them. And please remember to email us and including me at pavel.lasek@polsl.pl. You all should be familiar with me right now, so don't hesitate, because we will send you the physical prizes and we need your addresses, so don't worry. Or probably we will send it to the university and you can reach the prizes over there as a one package, you know, so don't worry. Okay, so I guess we are closing. We are closing the session. We've overdue like 30 minutes by now, and we are approaching the last parallel session of this conference. And I would like to thank Professor Marek Jasiński for the chairing this session, Professor Marcin Kasprzak for also chairing the session, and also Anton Rassolkin, professor from Tallinn University, for presenting awesome information and research on the digital twins. Thank you all for participating.
Thank you, Pavel, once again for a good session, for a great job to pick up all the presentation and inspire young people to send the presentation. I know that it's not easy, but congratulations for you.
Thank you. I have full email box by this time, you know, filled with the videos. We can do something about this later. Yeah.
Please consider a possible publication those two kinds of new kind video from student and undergraduate student and industrial electronics society YouTube channel as well.
Yes, if you maybe I will show it on the screen where you can see information related to it. If you give me a second. Okay, I need this thing. If you go to the Students and Young Professionals site, on the conference site over here, you can see the document related to the rules of 3-minute video. Maybe I will also email you as a reply. If you go to this document, there are emails to the people that are responsible for the PEMC videos that are visible on the IES YouTube channel. And as you can see, we've already have like 5 videos that were presented at the very beginning because that was the intention. But feel free to send them the videos and they will upload it to the YouTube channel so that everyone can see what you have prepared for us. That's it, I guess.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you all for participating in this session and have a nice evening, have a good day. The summer is approaching.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Thank you.
Congratulations once again, Carolina. You dominated this competition.
Thank you, Paweł.
Right. Congratulate.
I'm really glad.
Yes, definitely.
And the whole team from the Tallinn University also dominated this session. Great. So.
Yeah, one graduate student is right here with me. He's really happy. So
okay, good to hear that.
Carolina has today a very busy day because tomorrow morning she was the chair on the one session with me.
Yesterday, okay.
And so I don't know. Probably the competition was more nervous than a regular session on the morning.
Okay.
Exactly. But thank you once again. We're really glad.
Congratulations.
Okay. Thank you very much. Congratulate.
And thanks to all the people that were